Thank you very much. I'd like to thank Abhishek and Sanjib for asking me to give these lectures. It's a real pleasure to be here and a real pleasure to be among the other very distinguished speakers at the school. I'm really grateful to them for giving me this opportunity, because for quite some time I'd been thinking of collecting my thoughts on the subject and making notes. So this has given me a good excuse to do it. So I'm going to be giving you five pedagogical lectures on thermalization and quantum systems. And I have sent a tentative outline of the five lectures, which is on the website. I'll try to stick to that outline, but it could happen that there might be a spillover of stuff from one lecture onto the next one, or I might finish a lecture early and move into a different topic, but we'll see how that goes as we go along. So what I want to cover in these five lectures roughly is, what I want to tell you is that thermalization, which I will define as I go along, in quantum systems, is in some sense a different and perhaps richer phenomenon than its counterpart in classical systems. And again, I'll be a little more precise about that in maybe today's lecture and certainly in the next few lectures, what I mean by it being a richer phenomenon in quantum systems. So what I plan to do in, okay, so that's one of the things that I want to impress upon you, the fact that this is, for quantum systems, this phenomenon is in some sense different from what you encounter in classical systems, and how it's different and how one looks at thermalization from the point of view of quantum mechanics. So that's going to be the content of the first three and a half lectures. And after that, in the last lecture and maybe some part of the fourth lecture, I'll give you an introduction to a topic which has currently been receiving a lot of interest, which in some sense is mainly responsible for this renewed interest in the subject of thermalization in isolated systems, and that is something called many-body localization. So what I'll tell you is that many-body systems which undergo many-body localization are perhaps the only examples we have of isolated systems that generically do not thermalize, okay? And what I mean by isolated and generic is something which I'll make clear when I come to that part of the lecture series. So what I intend to do in today's lecture is give you a recap of those aspects of classical statistical mechanics which will be important for us to lay the groundwork to look at thermalization in quantum systems from the point of view of quantum mechanics. Now, statistical mechanics and statistical mechanics of classical systems is something which I'm sure most of you have been exposed to at various levels during your coursework and during your research. So, and I'm certainly not going to try to cover a large part of that subject. It's a huge subject, and the school is devoted to statistical physics. So what I'll be doing is I'll be looking at, as I said, only those aspects of classical statistical physics which will be important in order to compare and contrast the situation to what happens with quantum systems. So that's going to be a recap. So I'll do that for maybe half of today's lecture. And then in the second half of today's lecture, what I'll do is I'll try to introduce to you the machinery of looking at, machinery required to look at thermalization in quantum systems. What is the right framework? What does one mean by phase space for a quantum system? How does one look at average values and so on? What is the correct way of doing that? The most efficient way of doing that. So that's something which we look at in the second half of today's lecture. And because this is a school, I would encourage you to ask lots of questions. Please don't hesitate to stop me at any point, mid-sentence, mid-word, mid-syllable, it doesn't matter. Just stop and ask questions. Okay, so I'm going to start with a review of classical StatMech. those aspects which will be important to us for the subsequent discussion in this lecture series. So when we think of classical statistical mechanics, you know, and if you want to think of it concretely in terms of a model system, so one of the most studied model systems, and indeed the one that's usually used to introduce the subject, is a system of a classical gas. So where we can think of this classical system as basically being n particles, which obey classical Hamiltonian dynamics. So that's usually the setting in which you're introduced to the subject. And so let's assume that these n particles can interact with one another, and you know they obey Hamiltonian dynamics, so let's say Newton's laws of motion, and that they can move in d spatial dimensions. So that gives us the concept of a phase space for these particles. And what is the phase space? So the phase space is a 2D times N dimensional space. Okay. And what is the space? What are the different variables in the space? So this is the 2D n dimensional space. So in order to specify a point in the space, we need 2D n numbers, okay? Or 2D numbers per particle. And we know what these are. So these are basically components of the particle's position and the momentum. So for each dimension, there are two numbers. There's one position and one momentum. And so you have 2D of these per particle. There are n particles. So this is a 2D n dimensional phase space. And typically, of course, you consider the case where d is equal to 3, because that's, you know, what most real world examples are. And so you have a 6n dimensional phase space. So pictorially, you can think of the phase space as basically being some set of 6n axes. Of course, I can't draw 6n axes for n large, so I'm just going to draw this schematically with 3 axes, but you know, there are 6n axes. And every point in this phase space corresponds to 6n numbers. And what are these numbers? As I said, these are the values of the positions and the momenta of all these particles, okay? So if I specify all the positions and the momenta of the particles at any instant of time, I have specified the state of the gas, okay? And such a particle or such a state is what's called a microstate. So in statistical mechanics in your course, you come across the concept of microstates and macrostates. In this particular example, a microstate is just this. It's one such point in phase space, which has 6n numbers that are required to specify. Okay? Now, I'm going to assume that, and this will be important, that the system is isolated . So what does isolation mean? So isolation in my case means that the dynamics of the system in terms of these degrees of freedom, in terms of these variables, is completely deterministic. I don't need anything else to specify the dynamics of these particles. Okay? So the system is isolated and is described by a Hamiltonian. Isolated here means, in my case, completely deterministic dynamics in terms of So to contrast that with something that is not isolated, so for instance, if this system were in contact with the heat bath, and I'm sure you'd hear a lot about such systems during the course of the school, then of course you know that there are going to be stochastic forces that are acting on these particles because of the interaction of these particles with the degrees of freedom of the heat bath. Okay? So if I'm looking at the dynamics of the system itself, it isn't determined just by these, it is also determined by the degrees of freedom of the heat bath, which can act in some average sense on this system. Okay? But that's not the situation that I'm looking at here. I'm assuming that it's isolated, and why I'm looking at the case where it's isolated will, you know, why that's important is something which will become clear as I go along. Okay? So this is the setting in which you, you know, typically encounter statistical mechanics. your introduction to statistical mechanics is typically in this setting. Now, what we know is that because of the dynamics, you know, under the influence of the dynamics, the microstate evolves, which means that if at some particular time t, I know what these positions and momenta are, then if the dynamics is completely deterministic, I can in principle, although almost, you know, in most cases, never in practice, but almost, but always in principle, find out where the microstate will be after some amount of time t, okay? So then, if I want to look at the evolution of the system, starting from some initial state, that evolution is basically going to be some trajectory in this phase space, okay? So the evolution of this point is going to be some trajectory, and we know that the trajectory is not going to intersect itself, because at any point of time, if I know the state of the system, then I have, you know, that should uniquely tell me what the state of the system is later. So this is going to be some non-intersecting trajectory. So let me just say that this phase space trajectory, just to get the notation clear, is this where x is a phase space point with phi of t equal to 0 of x being equal to x. Okay, so at time t equal to 0, my phase point is x. If I know the initial point, then in principle, I know exactly where the system is going to be at any subsequent time t. So let me just call that point phi of t. Phi t of x, so it's a function of x and of time, okay? So this is the trajectory, this is how I parameterize the trajectory, and in principle, this is all there is to know about the system, okay? But of course, in practice, you know, this is not going to get us very far, because for any realistic system, this is almost impossible to calculate, given an x. So then the question is, how do we go about doing any calculations, and how do we then go about matching those calculations with something that can actually be observed? So that's where this tenet of statistical mechanics comes into play, which says that what is not important is, as far as observables are concerned, are individual microstates, meaning that, you know, you have an isolated system, and you know that the isolated system at any given point of time is going to be in some microstate, okay? But it's hopeless to try to, A, calculate that microstate starting from some initial microstate and the dynamics, and B, even try to measure in principle the microstate, meaning try to measure each of these, because typically there are just too many of them. You know, there's 10 to the 23 or something. But the whole point is that it doesn't matter. The things that we are interested in, the things which are actually physical properties which we might be interested in, we don't need to know the exact state of the system. What we have, what we need to know is in some sense some average state of the system. What we are interested in turns out to be some kind of average over these microstates of some meaningful physical property. Why that is the case, why it has to be an average, is something which we'll discuss in just a little bit. But that is the way we look at statistical mechanics, that what we're interested in are average properties, okay? And once we know how to average and what the right way of, what the right things to average over are, we can actually calculate quantities which can then be measured, which can then be compared with what you see in experiments and which can be used to make predictions. Okay, so pretty much all the statistical mechanics that you learn is about those kinds of calculations. Okay? But central to that is this principle of averaging over things. Okay? So let me now be a little more precise and talk about two different kinds of averages. So one of the averages that you encounter is a time average. Okay? And just to set the stage for what's coming next, let me actually talk about an infinite time average. Okay, and I'll tell you why infinite in just a little bit. So an infinite time average. So let me write that and then explain what it is. So this infinite time average is defined to be this. So S here is some physical quantity. At a mathematical level, you can just think of it as some integrable function of x. Okay, x, by the way, is something which is labeling these phase points. So f is some integrable function of f. Okay? And so this infinite time average is the following quantity. So you specify some initial state x, and then you look at the trajectory, which is phi t of x. At every instant of time t, you calculate the value of f, and then you average over this. Sorry, so 1 over t. For an infinite amount of time. Of course, you could also do it for a finite amount of time, but let me just define the infinite time average because it'll be useful in just a little bit, and we'll talk about finite time averages as well. So this is one kind of average, which is this infinite time average, which, as you can see, in principle depends on which point you have started from. Okay, there's an x here, and there's also an x here, and of course it depends on the particular quantity f. Now, so that's one kind of average. Then there's another kind of average, which is called the ensemble average. Okay? And what is the ensemble average? So let me use this symbol to denote the ensemble average. So the ensemble average for the same quantity S is this, where omega is the energy surface in phase space. Okay, so let me explain what that is. So we are looking at a system obeying Hamiltonian dynamics, okay? And suppose we say that the Hamiltonian doesn't have any explicit time dependence. It's not time dependent. The energy of the system is conserved. So then you know that when a system starts out at a particular phase point x, its subsequent trajectory has to lie on a constant energy surface because the energy is a conserved quantity. It's a constant of motion. There could be other constants of motion, okay? But for the time being, let's ignore them. So the energy is a constant of motion and the trajectory is constrained to be on this constant energy surface. But the ensemble average is basically the average of this quantity F over that energy surface, and it's an unbiased average. It's an average which treats every single microstate on the energy surface on equal footing. So it's just the integral of this over the energy surface divided by this, which is nothing but the volume of the energy surface in phase space. Okay, so this is an ensemble average, and that's a time average, an infinite time average. And these are the two kinds of averages which are important in statistical mechanics. And what sort of underlies the foundations of statistical mechanics, as we usually learn it, is that these two averages for any quantity f, integrable function f, okay, starting from almost any quantity, any initial state x, are equal. Okay, actually, before I write that down, let me point out that this quantity here, in principle, depends on x, right? Because here you're doing the average over a trajectory, and of course, you're averaging over the trajectory to infinite time, but it's still for a particular trajectory, which is labeled by a particular initial point. This average, on the other hand, is over the entire equal energy surface, okay? So this is not something which depends on x. You're actually integrating over all x. So this depends on x, but that doesn't. But the assertion which underlies statistical mechanics is something called, the ergodic hypothesis. It says that this is equal to that, okay, for all integrable functions f and almost all x. Okay, now what does almost all x mean? So almost all x here means that if you look at the set of x's, the set of initial points for which this isn't true, okay? So suppose you look at that set, and if you look at the volume of points in that set, then the volume of points in that set, so for x, for which, we just call this EH, for which EH is not true, we have dx is equal to zero. So what that tells you is that if you take the points for which this is not true, okay, and measure the volume of those points, then that volume is equal to zero. Or in more precise mathematical language, the initial points for which this doesn't hold are believed to be a set of measure zero. Okay, so are you familiar with that phrase, a set of measure zero? So that is the assumption here in the ergodic hypothesis. Now, before we proceed any further, let's just look at what that means physically. Okay, so that physically means that, so let's say that this is something which underlies statistical mechanics. Okay, of course, we'll question this, we'll look at, you know, what that really means, but for the time being, just think of statistical mechanics as you've normally learned it. So then the idea is that you start a system out, this isolated system out, in some initial microstate, and let it go. Let it evolve according to its own dynamics. And then eventually, although this definition doesn't yet tell us what eventually means, we'll also come to that, but eventually, no matter what initial state you started the system out from, the state of the system is an equilibrium state, which means that if you start making measurements of these physical observables after you waited long enough and you make successive measurements, you will see that the values of these observables are not changing very much. You know, they are by and large constant with some fluctuations, and the fluctuations are typically small as the size of your system is large, okay? And so the claim is that no matter what initial condition you start with, this is going to happen. And that is really what this is saying. But this is actually saying that it doesn't have to be true for every single initial condition that you can think of, all right? So can someone give me an example of something like that? So let's say we take a system like this, okay? Let's say that we've got these classical particles in a box, and let's assume that these particles are balls, okay? Are hard spheres which can collide with each other. And such a system is believed to thermalize, is believed to eventually go to an equilibrium distribution. When I say believe, there's no rigorous proof of this, but there's enough evidence based on numerical simulations that this happens for almost all initial conditions. But can someone think of an initial condition for which this will not happen? Can anyone give me an example? Okay. So let me tell you, let me give you one example of an initial condition for which this will not happen. So imagine that you have n particles in this box, okay? And imagine that the initial condition that you started the system out with is having all n particles. So this is a three-dimensional box, but you put all n particles in a single two-dimensional plane. Okay, so then if you look at the density of particles, the physical density of particles, and the physical density of particles is a delta function now, okay, at the location of this plane. So imagine that is your initial condition in terms of where the particles are. And also imagine that you give them all the same speed, the same velocity, and in a direction which is perpendicular to the plane. What's going to happen there? Okay, so here's the plane. The plane is parallel to one of the walls of the box. It's a rectangular box. All your particles are at time t equal to zero sitting in that plane. And at time t equal to zero, I give them all the same velocity. Okay. Actually, even that's not important in this case, but assume it's the same velocity, and which is only perpendicular to the plane. So what's going to happen? So then you know that this plane of particles will just move all together, hit the wall, bounce back, and just keep bouncing back and forth. And that is clearly not an equilibrium distribution for that particular energy. Okay? So that, for instance, is an example of an initial state for which this will not work. But the claim is that if you look at the set of all such states for which this doesn't work, the set of all such states is a set of measure Z. Okay? So this is called the ergodic hypothesis, and this underlies is your question, what is a set of measure zero? Okay. So a set of measure zero is basically something like this. So imagine that, so let's look in three dimensions, okay? So in three dimensions, the measure of some surface is the volume that that surface occupies, okay? So if I now look at a single point in three dimensions, the volume of that point is zero, so a single point is a set of measure zero, okay? If I look at a line, if I give you a line segment and I ask you what was the volume of a line segment, that is also zero, as is the volume of an area segment, okay? So in order for something to not be zero, to actually have a volume, it can't be a point, it can't be a line segment, it can't be a set of discrete points, it can't be an area segment, it can't be a set of discrete area segments, it actually has to be a volume, okay? So the claim here is that if you now look at this phase space, which is dn dimensional, and you look at the initial points for which this doesn't hold, and you ask what is the total volume, the dn dimensional volume of that set of points, that is equal to zero. Okay? Any other question? Okay, good. So this is the ergodic hypothesis. And so another statement of the ergodic hypothesis which you might have heard is that when a system is ergodic, then the amount of time, the fraction of the time that it spends in any volume of phase space is equal to the fraction that that volume occupies on the energy surface, okay? Or another way of putting it is that the amount of time spent by the system in any volume is proportional to, in any region of phase space, is proportional to the volume of that region of phase space, okay? So as an exercise, try to prove the second statement starting from the first statement. So if you look, okay, I guess the problem set hasn't been posted yet. Okay, so I've sent a problem set to the organizers. The first problem in the problem set is for you to prove that if you're given this statement, okay, if the ergodic hypothesis holds in this form, this implies that the amount of time spent by a system in a given region of phase space is going to be proportional to its volume. That follows from this, and that is something which is an exercise for you to prove, and we can go over this during the tutorial in the afternoon, okay? All right, so a simple example of an ergodic system example of an ergodic. Okay, so I should mention that, you know, this is a very important condition. It underlies statistical mechanics, but it is very hard to prove for any given system. Okay, in fact, I mean, I'm by no means an expert on this, but the number of systems for which ergodicity has been rigorously proved is really very, very small. Okay, and but this is something which we believe holds for a large number of systems, especially when the number of degrees of freedom is very large, and the degrees of freedom are interacting with one another. But proving it is difficult. But one system for which you can actually prove this, okay, so simple ergodic system. Is a one-dimensional harmonic oscillator, by which I mean a system which has only one degree of freedom, okay? And let's say it has a Hamiltonian that looks like this. Now, the reason that I've written the Hamiltonian like this, of course, you know that a one-dimensional harmonic oscillator has a Hamiltonian that's p squared by 2m plus half kx squared. But the reason I've written that like this, with, you know, a factor of omega which comes out, is that writing it like this, scaling things this way, gives you nice constant energy surfaces which are circles in phase space. Okay, so that makes some of the analysis easy. So this is a system with just one degree of freedom. Okay, so one-dimensional harmonic oscillator. And this is an example of an ergodic system. This is something for which you can rigorously prove that. Okay? In fact, for this system, even this doesn't apply. For this system, for every x, for every initial point, you can show that this happens. And this is also an exercise for you in your first problem set, that the one-dimensional harmonic oscillator is an ergodic system. Okay? Actually, I should mention here that it turns out that there's nothing special about the one-dimensional harmonic oscillator. Any Hamiltonian system with a single degree of freedom, which has some bound phase space, is actually ergodic. Okay, that's correct, isn't it? So this, of course, is a particularly simple example of that, where you can see it quite easily. And so this is something which is in your problem set, and we can go over this during the tutorial. Okay. So that was the ergodic hypothesis. This is a very simple example of an ergodic system. But again, let me emphasize that the systems which we are interested in when we study statistical mechanics are not like this at all. They're not systems with just one degree of freedom. One degree of freedom is very pathological. They're systems with large numbers of degrees of freedom, where proving the ergodic hypothesis becomes difficult. Okay, fine. So then there's another concept that's very important here, related to Hamiltonian dynamics, which you're all familiar with, and that is something called Liouville's theorem. And what it tells you is this. So imagine that at time t equal to zero, you start with phase space points, not a single phase space point, but a set of phase space points which occupy some volume in phase space. Okay? So that is your initial state. And so there's a certain phase space density corresponding to this. And then you let the system evolve, let this volume evolve according to Hamiltonian dynamics. Okay? And what's going to happen, of course, is that this shape that you have, this this particular shape that you have, is going to change as a function of time. But what Liouville's theorem tells you is two things. One is that no matter how the shape changes, at any given instant of time, whatever shape it evolves into has exactly the same phase space volume as what you started with. And also, if you look at the number of points contained inside that volume, it's the same as the number of points that you started with. Points can't leak out of a given volume. Because if points could leak out of a given volume, that would mean that two of these phase-space trajectories would intersect, which is not allowed. So nothing can leave the surface. And in addition to that, the volume is conserved. Okay. So something like this can evolve into a shape which looks like that. And while this on the board might look like it's bigger, okay, it's actually not. I'm assuming that it sort of got more spread out in some sense over phase space, meaning that if this was a big lump, then as this thing has evolved, it's flattened out more. But the volume is still the same. The volume can't change. And in fact, if you think of this as, so volume is preserved. Okay. And now, if you think of this as being infinitesimal to begin with, okay, and after some time you get a new surface, which is new shape, which is also infinitesimal in size, then you can relate the density that you started with here. So it's an infinitesimal element, so you can associate a density with this infinitesimal element, a phase space density, and a phase space density with this infinitesimal element. Okay, and these have to be the same because the volumes are the same and the number of phase space points is the same. So if you now look at, so what that tells you is that if you are looking at the phase space density at any point x at time t, okay, that is going to be equal to the phase space density at time t equal to 0 at this point. Okay, so remember that the point which is at x at time t got there from phi of minus t of x, because that was our definition of the trajectory. And so this initial density, okay, which was what the density of the initial density was, the density at this initial point was, has to be equal to the final density, and this is just that statement. Okay, so this is the statement of Liouville's theorem. This is true for all t and for all x, which belong to this phase space volume. Okay. So we've written down the ergodic hypothesis, we've defined phase space, and we have talked about calculating averages. But now the question is, why is any of this useful, and how does any of this apply to statistical mechanics as we know it? Okay. So the point here is that we have these two quantities, this and this. This is the ensemble average, this is the time average. Okay. So the philosophy is that this is what we calculate. Okay. So we calculate, so you give me a physical observable which corresponds to some f, and then I can in principle calculate that using a variety of techniques over the entire constant energy ensemble. Okay. Now, here I've assumed that the only constant of motion is the energy. In principle, there could be other constants of motion, and we'll discuss those constants of motion and the importance of those constants of motion in tomorrow's lecture. But then if there are other constants of motion, then of course this surface over which you have to do the integral is not just a constant energy surface. It would also correspond to constant values of those other quantities. Okay, but this is something which we can calculate. Or for instance, in the kinds of cases that you heard about in the morning, in this morning's lecture, you can relax the constraint of this system being isolated, assume that it's in contact with some heat bath, with which it can exchange energy. So the energy is no longer a constant. It can exchange energy with a heat bath, but in such a way that the energy of the system plus the heat bath is a constant, okay? And which, as you all know, is a canonical ensemble. And in a situation like that, again, there are techniques to calculate this in various situations, some of which you heard about in the morning. So this is what we calculate, okay? But what about this? So the importance of the ergodic hypothesis is that we claim that this is actually what you see in measurements. Okay, that when you make a measurement on a system of a particular quantity f, the idea is that you're making the measurement over a certain amount of time. Okay? And then what you get at the end of the measurement is not the value of that quantity at some particular instant of time, but is something which is averaged over a certain amount of time, which is equal to the time of the measure. Okay? And so then you would say that because what you measure is something that's a time average, it would be natural in some sense to identify it with this. But note that there's a problem. The problem is that here we've defined this for a time t going to infinity. Okay, that was our definition of f star of x. Now, if we want to make this identification of what we measure with this time average, then somehow we'd have to argue that either that the amount of time taken to make the measurement is infinite, or even if it's not, which it clearly isn't, we have to argue that the amount of time for which we are making the measurement is in some sense effectively infinite. Okay, is like, even though it's a finite time average, is like what you would get had you considered that to be infinite. And then in a situation like that, you can try to, you can then say that this, these two being equal to each other, will give you a physical basis of statistical mechanics, if you can make that identification. But then there's a problem now. So now you have to justify that the amount of time for which you make the measurement is effectively infinite. So how do you know whether it's effectively infinite? What do you do to quantify that? So it turns out that there's really no sensible way in which you can do that. And the reason is the following. So let's just go back to our ideal gas, let's just go back to our gas of particles again and ask, what does effectively infinite mean in terms of time? So you might think that effectively infinite would mean an amount of time during which this system of particles samples most of the microstates on this constant energy surface. If that happens, then you can see that this would be true, right? But then you have to make an estimate of how much time it would take for a realistic system to sample most or all of the microstates on a constant energy surface, okay? So when you make that estimate, so time taken t to sample, let's say most of omega, what you will find is that this actually is something which is greater than an exponential in the number of particles that you have. Okay? And why that is the case is something that you can think about, or we can discuss it in the tutorial. But it's going to scale as, you know, something which is greater than an exponential in the number of particles, and of course we're looking at a time scale, multiplied by some microscopic time scale. Now, what is the microscopic time scale here? So the microscopic time scale for the kind of system that we are considering, for instance, is like an average time for collision between two particles. Okay? And this is again something which I'm assuming that all of you have been exposed to in one form or the other when you've done statistical mechanics. So that is some microscopic time scale. But the claim is that this time scale is going to be larger than e to the n times that microscopic time scale. So if you think of 1 mole of an ideal gas, or 1 mole of a gas, which has 10 to the power of 23 molecules, okay, then this is going to be greater than exponential 10 to the power of 23 times tau zero. And even if you take tau zero to be very conservatively 10 to the power of minus 15 seconds or minus 18 seconds or some ridiculously small time scale, this is clearly going to be larger than the age of the universe. Okay? So then this argument of identifying f star of x with a time of measurement, you know, with an average over the time of measurement, this infinite time average with an average over the actual time of measurement, clearly doesn't work. Okay? So we have to come up with some other justification for why you can say that an ensemble average that you can calculate is actually going to be equal to what you measure in experiment. This line of argument will not work. Okay? So this actually is something which was very well known to the founding fathers of statistical mechanics, right? That this is not something which you should identify with the average that you get over the time that you do the measurement for. What we need is actually something which is a lot stronger, which is what we encounter in terms of everyday experience with statistical mechanics systems. Yeah. Sorry? Right. Yes. So the point is, yes, you can do that. But here it's not obvious that you can do it this way, right? This, if so, what you're saying is correct. it is true that the infinite time average can be identified with what you're calling the steady state average, and we'll see how that happens. Okay, but if you were to just naively say that this infinite time average is what you will actually get in a measurement, because the time over which you're doing the measurement is effectively infinite, then that argument doesn't work even for a simple system like this. Okay, so we need some other argument to explain why what you see in a measurement is equal to the steady state average that you're talking about, which in turn is equal to this infinite time average. Okay, yeah. Tutorial, or think about it, or then tutorial. Okay. Fine. So what we need is actually something stronger, and what is the stronger condition? So let's just go back to our everyday experience with these systems which obey statistical mechanics. So, you know, this gas, for instance. So let's assume that you start this gas out in something which you know is not an equilibrium state. So imagine that you take all these particles, and you confine all these particles with some, you know, random velocities, but confine them to one small part of the box. Okay? Now clearly, and that's your t equal to zero state, and clearly that's not an equilibrium state, because you know that in equilibrium the particles will uniformly fill the box, and this state is nothing like it. You do that and you let the particles go. And then what's going to happen is, eventually after a sufficiently long time, if you were to then look at the box, and if you were to make measurements of the density locally at different points, you would find that that density is going to be the same, up to fluctuations. Okay? So what we see is that you start from some initial state, you wait for a sufficient amount of time, and subsequently after that sufficient amount of time, almost at every instant of time after that initial amount of time, you are going to be in a state where when you make a measurement, you will get this value. So what we want is not that some infinite time average of this is going to be equal to this ensemble average. What we want is for a long time value of the quantity to be equal to the ensemble average. Okay? So what we really want is this. So what we need, maybe I'll go back to that side of the board, is something like this. So the limit t going to infinity, but again, here when I say t going to infinity, I mean at time scales which are larger than some reasonable time scale, some time scale over which you can see things changing in experiments, and we'll again see what this sort of time scale is for practical systems in just a little bit. Okay, so what we need is this kind of condition. Okay, and again, for almost we need this, and this, as I said, even though I'm saying t going to infinity, what I really mean is t much larger, t larger than some reasonable time scale, which is, you know, the microscopic time scale times something which doesn't which is not something which is exponential in the number of degrees of freedom, perhaps a power law in the number of degrees of freedom or something like that. Okay, so once your t is larger than that, we want this to happen. Okay. And you can see that if this happens, then of course even this will happen, right? Because then when you make, assuming that it doesn't, assuming of course that once this has happened, the system remains in that equilibrium state, it doesn't slip out for large periods of time from the equilibrium state. Because if that were the case, then that limit, then this limit wouldn't exist. For this limit to exist, that shouldn't happen, okay? So if this is true, then, of course, even the average will be equal to this. So if we know this happens, which is a much stronger condition than saying that the infinite time average is equal to the ensemble average, then we have a much better notion of what it means for a system to equilibrium. Okay? So is that clear to everyone? Okay, actually, let me just see how I'm doing on time. I think this clock... Okay. Good. All right, so this is what we want. So maybe I should, okay, now that I've laid sort of the conceptual foundation, I'm going to speed up a little bit in terms of the math. So the question really is, how do we justify this? This is a justification for this. And here there are two approaches, both of which will be important. Contrasting these two approaches will be important for us when we look at quantum statistical mechanics. So the one which is, so approach number one, which is the one which is, which you typically encounter in textbooks on statistical mechanics, is what's called the Gibbsian or the ensemblist approach. Okay. And so what is the Gibbsian or the ensemblist approach? So the claim is that you don't start, you don't think of the isolated system as starting from a single phase point. You don't do that. Okay. What you do instead is you say that at time t equal to zero, the system was actually in an ensemble. Okay. So this is at time t equal to zero, we have the system in some ensemble of points, not in a single phase point. Okay. And then you let the system evolve. All right. So how does that help? So then the claim is that the dynamics of a system for which this happens will be such that if you wait long enough, the system is going to evolve in such a way that even though it starts out from a collection of phase points in a tiny volume, if you wait sufficiently long, this set of points in this tiny volume is going to densely fill up the entire phase space in a way that is consistent with Liouville's theorem. Okay? So remember that you can't buck Liouville's theorem. But what you can do is you can take something like this, which is, you know, like this very compact object that you're starting with in phase space, and then let it evolve, and then it's going to flatten out and spread, and eventually it's going to cover almost all of the constant energy surface. And once that happens, you know, once, and if this happens in a reasonable amount of time, reasonable in the sense that's defined here, then you know that this is going to happen. Okay? So this is the Gibbsian approach. And so this, excuse me, okay? So what this says is that for this to happen, you start with some rho zero of x, okay? And then what happens is that it becomes, as time progresses, this becomes some rho of phi t of x, which in this t going to infinity limit goes to rho microcanonical. Okay, so now I'm going to introduce the word microcanonical, which many of you are familiar with. So microcanonical simply means an equally weighted average over all phase points. Okay, so meaning that you're now looking at a density over this entire phase volume, which has an equal weight for all microstates on this constant energy surface. So rho zero of x, which after a certain time t becomes rho of phi t of x according to Hamiltonian evolution. But the claim is that as t goes to infinity, this goes to the microcanonical value. Okay? So now you can ask, what is the mechanics for this to happen? Okay? Now one thing which, again, the founding fathers of statistical mechanics were very aware of was that there is really no, without any, without additional inputs into this argument, this can never happen. And the reason this can never happen is that rho microcanonical, okay, so rho microcanonical, let me just define that. Rho microcanonical is this density, which is that. Okay? So the density at any phase space point x is just 1 divided by the entire volume of the constant energy surface. So now if you're claiming that some initial density as a function of time can evolve into this density, then there's fundamentally a problem. And the reason there's a problem is that this evolution is happening according to Liouville's theorem, according to regular Hamiltonian evolution. And if you were to calculate how the density evolves as a function of time, this is what the density does as a function of time, where this is a Poisson bracket. So I'm assuming all of you are familiar with the Poisson bracket, okay? And so what that tells you is that if you have a density which is some function of h, and clearly this is some function of h, it's a constant function of h, then that Poisson bracket is equal to zero, or in other words, that's a stationary density. So if you have to get to this density, you always have to have been at that density. You can't evolve into that density, okay? So then there's a problem with how you can justify this, even if you want it to be true. How do you start from some initial density and say that as a function of time, it evolves into the microcanonical density, when the microcanonical density itself can't have any time dependence, okay? So the answer, so the solution to this is through something called coarse graining. And the idea here is that you take your entire phase space and you divide it into cells. And what you say is, and the cells of some phase space volume, and what you say is that when you're calculating things like this, some quantity averaged over some density, what this is really equal to is a sum of f of xi, rho of xi. So you're only specifying the density in these cells. So you divide it into a discrete number of cells, okay? And you're only specifying the density in each cell without worrying about how the density varies within a cell. There's only one number per cell, okay? So this is a form of coarse graining. It's a form of coarse graining like the kind of coarse graining that you heard about in the morning. The only thing is that this coarse graining is in phase space. It is not in real space. And then you can show that once you have got rid of this, once you've introduced coarse graining, then a density that's been specified in the coarse grained sense can actually evolve to a microcanonical density also in the coarse grained sense. Okay, that there is really no Liouville's equation for these coarse grained densities. So something can actually tend to this microcanonical density if you have coarse grain. So this also, in some sense, explains something which you might have been doing in statistical mechanics all along without really worrying about it too much. So when you do classical statistical mechanics, and let's say you're calculating all kinds of stuff, and you're doing integrals over phase space, you always have to introduce a volume of a phase set. And to count the number of states in a particular large volume of phase space, you say that there is a fundamental small volume of phase space which has a certain, a phase cell which has a certain volume. Now, why do you need that? Now, when you're doing quantum statistical mechanics, there's usually an explanation that's given in terms of the uncertainty principle, saying that you can't determine x and p exactly, so there's no phase point, there's actually a volume. But why do you need to do that in statistical, in classical statistical mechanics? So this is the reason that you need to do it, okay? So there is coarse graining which you need to put in into classical statistical mechanics. Okay, fine. No, it's not breaking any, this is a coarse graining in phase space. Okay, so is your question about how things become irreversible in statistical mechanics? Is that? Okay, actually, so the interesting thing here is that something which is usually not appreciated is this. So let's say I give you rho zero of x, okay, and you are proceeding forwards in time, e going to plus infinity, you go to the microcanonical ensemble. Suppose I give you the same rho of x, okay, and you proceed backwards in time, okay? you will find that you will again go back to the microcanonical ensemble. Why that is true? So this irreversible, okay, so at that level, this dynamics is completely reversible. It's just that we happen to be proceeding forwards in time. But if you, you know, we don't ask where the rho zero of x came from. You were just given a rho zero of x, and then you let the system proceed. And you see that it becomes microcanonical. But let's assume there's some history to it. Where did the rho zero of x come from in the first place? So if you could actually move backwards in time, you would see that the same thing would happen. Okay? Why that is the case, we'll probably get to at the end of this lecture. Okay? It has something to do with something called typicality. But for the time, if not, if you don't get to it, we can again discuss this in the tutorial. Okay? So I'm saying, let's assume that your initial, yeah. No, I'm not saying the volume is expanding. The volume can't change while you will steer. What can happen is something which was this very compact lump of points in phase space can now spread out. It can become thinner in this direction, wider in that direction, okay? Total number of points is fixed. The total volume is fixed. Neither of those can change, okay? But it can still densely, because this itself is a continuous dense object, it can deform in such a way that it can densely occupy all of phase space. No. See, there's a constant energy surface. Okay? What we are doing is we are starting with some state which has a density which is non-zero only in some part of that surface. Every point on that constant energy surface has the same energy. Okay? So you start the system out in this ensemble of points in a certain part of the constant energy surface, okay, and then you let it evolve. Now, every point in this has to always evolve to a point which is exactly at the same energy, because energy is conserved in the dynamics. You can't change that. What can change is the shape of this thing. So your question about it was going into some point which was not initially occupied, why was that point initially not occupied? Because I didn't let it be occupied. I gave you an initial condition where that point was not occupied. Okay. All right. Let me just give you a quick answer, and we'll again address this in the tutorial. The quick answer is that don't think of this as a collection of discrete points. Right? This is of something which has a finite volume in phase space. So this is like when, let's say, you are kneading dough or something, okay? You make a small ball of the dough, and then you knead it, okay? You flatten it out. The number of dough points or molecules is the same. The volume of the dough is still the same, but it has flattened out. That's what's happening here, okay? All right. Okay. So you need some coarse graining in order for this to work, right? But that's not enough. The other thing which we need is something which is even more fundamental. So the coarse graining is required for you to explain how something can evolve into a density which is a stationary density, right? So that for that you need coarse graining, but you still have, yeah. Okay, so, all right, so how is it helping to satisfy this? This is, all right, so a partial answer to this is in problem number 3 in the problem set that I have posted, okay? So one thing which you can see if you didn't have any coarse graining, another problem that would happen is that, so I haven't introduced the entropy yet, okay? But imagine now, I mean, all of you know what the entropy is. All of you have seen expressions for the entropy in terms of a phase space density. So the entropy in terms of the phase space density is minus rho log rho integrated over the entire phase space. I give you a phase space density, the entropy is minus rho log rho integrated over the entire phase space. Okay. So let's say you start with some rho zero of x. So at time t equal to zero, you calculate the entropy, you get something. And then you let the system evolve according to Hamiltonian dynamics. What you will find is that this integral of minus rho log rho is not going to change as a function of time. Okay. So what that tells you is that if you were to define entropy as minus rho log rho integrated over the whole phase space, whatever entropy you started with, you will be stuck with that entropy forever. which is not what you see. Okay? So what you see is that the entropy of this isolated system will increase when you start from some non-equilibrium state. And for that to happen, once again, your entropy can't be minus rho log rho integral over the whole space. What you actually need it to be is something like minus sum over I, p log pi over these cells, and then the thing, and then it can increase. Okay? So there are many different arguments for why you need coarse graining, but you need coarse graining because and all of these are essentially coming because this is a stationary density. Nothing can actually evolve towards a stationary density. So in order to make this thing work, you need coarse graining. Okay? So that's one point. The other point is that coarse graining by itself is not enough. Okay? So what you also need is for this basic thing to happen, which is that you start with something which is very concentrated, okay, and then you need it to spread out, and spread out in a nice fashion so that after a sufficient amount of time, it covers most of the, when I say most, you know, I mean something other than a set of measure zero of this constant energy surface. Okay? So which means that points which were very close to each other in this initial shape will now have to spread out by a large amount to cover this surface. So that is another ingredient that you need. Okay? In addition to having coarse graining, you need this to happen. So this is, of course, you know, there's a whole literature on this, which I'm not going to go into, but this is something which is called mixing, okay? But for our purpose, for the rest of this lecture series, I'm going to refer to this as chaos, okay? So now there's subtle differences between what you mean by mixing and chaos. There's no one general definition for chaos, but when I'm going to use chaos, at least in the context of classical systems, this is what I mean. That you start the system out with some phase space density, which is highly concentrated like this. It's like this one small ball of dough. And then you let the system evolve. And points which were very close to each other, after a reasonable amount of time, become, you know, get quite far apart from one another. So the trajectories that these points follow separate very soon, and by a huge amount as a function of time. So there's an exponential separation of these trajectories. And this is what's called, this at least is what I'm going to call chaos here. So if you wanted to know, if you look at some point on some trajectory at some later instant of time, and if you wanted to predict where it came from, okay, and you do this for two different trajectories, then these two different trajectories could be wildly, you know, these two different points at a later instant of time could be wildly separated, but they could have originated from two points which were very close to one another. So what you need for all of this to work is you need coarse graining and you also need chaos. Okay? So let me write this down. So you have coarse graining plus chaos is required to give you this thing. Okay. So sometimes this condition, you know, this coarse graining plus chaos giving you this, sometimes this is also referred to as ergodicity and not that, what I'd written down there. But this, you can see, is a stronger condition than that. This implies that, but that doesn't imply this. So once again, an example of a system which is ergodic but not mixing or chaotic is this one. Okay, so this is an ergodic system, but it doesn't have this property that when you take two phase space points which are very close to one another at t equal to zero and look at their evolution, they will not get wildly separated from one another. And this is again something which you can, you know, which is in your first problem set. Okay. Well, okay, so right. So it would really, so there it depends, which I haven't got to yet. it could be different for different Fs, for different properties that you're looking at. Not everything has to equilibrate over the same time scale. But if you now look at, you know, some typical system like this gas and ask for most observables, what would that time scale be? So for most observables, that time scale would be something like L squared divided by D. So if you have some typical dimension of this gas, you know, it's in some volume which is characterized by some dimension L, then it's basically going to be, you know, bounded by the amount of time it'll take for something to diffuse across this this system. So it'll be something like L squared by D. But how you actually get this time scale starting from some particular kind of chaotic dynamics with some Lyapunov exponents, I think, is a fairly complicated thing. No, okay, so I'm assuming that these particles are hard spheres, okay? So what that means is that these particles are like balls and with a certain radius. And when they come close to one another and when their centers are separated by exactly the, you know, when these balls touch, that's when they suffer elastic collisions. But otherwise, nothing happens. Now, the thing is that you need that, because if you didn't, if let's say you assume that these were point particles, then there would be absolutely no route for this thing to equilibrate, right? Because then they would just be complete, each particle would be completely oblivious of the presence of every other particle. So then there'd be no mechanism for this to happen. See, the mechanism for this to happen is being provided by the dynamics, right? And so the dynamics has to have this mechanism of collisions in it. Any other questions? No. Okay. Good point. Okay. So here, okay, so what this tells you is that you need coarse graining. What this doesn't tell you is how coarse grained, you know, what should be the size of this cell. Now, the thing is, how big the cell should be would depend on things like, you know, imagine that you're concentrating your initial phase space density in one of these cells. And after a certain amount of time, you want it to spread out and, you know, occupy most of the constant energy surface. Then how small this cell can be for that to happen will, of course, depend on how, you know, how these trajectories deviate from one another, what the Lyapunov exponents are, and you know, how large your system is, and so on. But the claim, of course, is that if you happen to be in the thermodynamic limit, okay, and, okay, well, forget the thermodynamic, actually, I'll come to that, okay, just for the time being, pretend that you're in the thermodynamic limit, and you can take T going to infinity in a certain way, right, then it doesn't matter how small these are, you will still eventually reach this distribution. Meaning that no matter how tiny it is, if you wait long enough, things will spread sufficiently so that it will cover most of the constant energy surface. Okay. So this, all right, so coarse graining plus chaos will give you this. And, right, and in what sense, so what will happen as a consequence? So what will happen as a consequence is that if you look at limit T going to infinity, x dx, okay? So this, for any density, this is going to go to f of x, rho microcanonical of x, which of course doesn't depend on x, dx, okay? So this will imply this, okay? And So this is the way statistical mechanics is normally presented. But then there's another point of view, which is not usually emphasized in statistical mechanics textbooks, but is the point of view which is going to be of fundamental importance to looking at quantum statistical mechanics. And that is, so this was approach one. So approach two is what's called the Boltzmannian or the individualist point of view. Okay. Now, what is the Boltzmannian point of view? So the Boltzmannian point of view says that you don't think of the starting state of the system as an ensemble. You actually think of it as a single phase point. What is the reason for you to do that? Well, the reason for you to do that would be you would say in some sense that thinking of the initial state of a completely isolated system as an ensemble is unjustified. What put it in that ensemble in the first place? If it was completely isolated and its dynamics was completely deterministic, why should it start out being in an ensemble? Who made it that way? So instead, you don't do that. You say that it is actually in a single state, in a single microstate. But then, if it's in a single microstate, how do you justify this? Okay. Here, of course, the justification came from the fact that you had chaos and coarse graining. And so even though you started with some concentrated density, it would eventually spread out and cover the entire microcanonical surface. But here you have this one point, okay? And even if you have chaos, a single point is just going to go to a single point. So then how do you justify that? So the justification for this is, okay, so here what you have is you have rho zero of x is always going to be some delta of x minus x zero, okay? And so as a result of this, rho t of x, if you look at the density at any subsequent time t, this is going to be delta of x minus one phase space point. One phase space point. All of these x is a point in phase space, okay? So even here, when I'm talking about an ensemble, I'm talking about an ensemble of points in phase space. These are not n molecules concentrated in some volume of real space. I'm talking about points in phase space. Okay? So you have this, right? So this has to happen. So this is a single microstate. This also has to be a single microstate. Clearly, you can see that there is no sense in which this can tend to that. This is not something which is a delta function. That is something which is a delta function. And you'd say, well, if you take this point of view, then you're dead in the water because there's no way in which this can become that. But you say, fine, you know, it's not really this that we're interested in. What we're interested in is that, right? What we finally care about are observables. So then the question is there any way in which with this point of view, we can get this relation, okay? So if you just take this and substitute it here, what you will find is, so limit t going to infinity, will now imply, if I just plug this in here, will now imply that limit t going to infinity, f of phi t of x0 goes to so what this is telling you is that if this has to be true, if there's a way in which this can be reconciled with this, it has to be that if you start the system out in a single microstate and wait sufficiently long, then it's going to end up in some microstate, phi t of x0, which is such that if you were to then calculate some typical observable in that one single microstate, its value would be what you would get for the entire microcanonical ensemble, okay? So here there is no notion of starting with an ensemble, evolving into an ensemble. You always have just one single microstate, which is becoming one single microstate. But if this has to be true, it should be that eventually, no matter which microstate you start from, aside from maybe a set of measure zero, the microstate that you end up in has to be such that if you were to look at some typical physical quantity in that one single microstate, it would have a value which is equal to the microcanonical value. It would have a value as if that value was obtained by averaging over the entire microcanonical ensemble. Okay? Now, this is a pretty strong statement. We are talking about individual microstates behaving like, in some sense, the entire ensemble when it comes to typical observable values. And so this is related to the issue of what's called typicality. So the idea is something like this. And so this is really, this goes back to Boltzmann, and it's something which has been refined over the years by a lot of people. And it's a point of view which is different from the Gibbs point of view. Here you don't start with an ensemble. But what you do is the following. You say that your phase space is actually divided into various cells. And I'll tell you what a cell is in just a second. Okay. So it looks like this. So these cells are not to be confused with those cells which I introduced because I had to introduce coarse graining. These are cells which are larger than those cells. Each of these contains many of those small cells. Okay? So now the idea is that, so this is the phase space volume, and you look at one of these cells, what is it that defines a cell? So what defines a cell basically is the value of typical observables, okay, observables that you're interested in experiments, the values of those observables in these cells. So if I compare two cells, what I'll find is that these typical observable, the values of these typical observables in these cells will be different. So I look at a collection of microstates for which the values of these typical observables are roughly the same. That defines for me a cell. Then, you know, neighboring that, there's going to be another cell where the values of these typical observables, all the microstates in it, are going to be different. And then another one and so on, okay? But then what you will find is that this, so the belief is, again, you know, there are no formal proofs, that if you look at the structure of phase space here, you will find that these cells are not all of the same size. And the size of the phase cell will keep increasing the more the values start tending towards this. Okay, so you look at a particular cell and you ask how close are the values of typical observables in that cell to their microcanonical values, and how big that cell is going to depend on how close these values are to these. Okay, so the closer these values are to these values, the larger the cell is going to be, and the cell which has the largest volume and the overwhelmingly large volume is the one for which these are going to be equal to those. Okay. So here the idea is that you have a cell which is overwhelmingly large, okay, with F equal to F microcanonical in this cell. Okay, so that most of the phase, the overwhelmingly large part of the volume of the constant energy surface is occupied by this cell. Okay? So then what happens is, you start the system out in some particular microstate, let's say it's in this cell, and then as it evolves, it's going to go through, you know, different cells, and eventually it's going to end up in this cell, because this is the one which has the largest volume. Okay? And once it is in this cell, it's going to be very hard for it to leave this cell, because, you know, the overwhelmingly large volume is in this cell. So this is the way that you have equilibrium happening in the individualist point of view. That you go from cell to cell to cell to cell, progressively larger cells, till you end up in this equilibrium cell, which is the one which has the overwhelmingly large volume. Okay? So these are the two different points of view. And you can ask, well, why do you need two different points of view? So at a certain level, of course, you could say that the two different points of view are required, you know, are probably philosophical differences. It comes from whether you believe that a system which is truly isolated can start out being in an ensemble of states, or does it necessarily have to start from a single state? Okay, but you say, fine, okay, you know, that's maybe a philosophical difference. Is there any tangible, measurable difference between these points of view? Will they give me different answers finally? Now, whether I'm saying that the approach to equilibrium is like this through coarse graining plus chaos, or whether I'm saying that the approach to equilibrium is like this through these cells and typicality. So this, by the way, is called typicality, meaning that you're saying that most microstates are in this one cell, which is the equilibrium cell, where physical quantities have their typical equilibrium values. Okay, that is typicality. Now you can say, well, is there a difference in terms of actual predictions? And it turns out that there's actually one big difference, which is extremely important, and which is sort of the launching point for thermalization and quantum systems. Okay, so let me just introduce that, and then I'll end, and I'll start with thermalization and quantum systems in the next lecture. So the one big difference is this. Okay, so if you just go back, if you just think about your statistical mechanics, your introductory course, where you learned about ensembles, and so we've been talking about the microcanonical ensemble, but there's also the canonical ensemble which you heard about in the morning. Okay, and you know that in the canonical ensemble, there is a different density. It's not this, because the energy is not fixed anymore. The energy can fluctuate. So what the density is depends on the energy and the temperature. And a particular microstate now occurs with a probability which is proportional to e to the power of minus the energy of the microstate divided by kBT. So you can ask, well, where does that come from? How do you get that? So the standard way of deriving that is, you say that this system, which you want to consider in the microcanonical ensemble, is contained in a larger isolated system, okay? With the larger isolated system being like this, okay? And then, so this system is contained in the larger isolated system. And so the system that you're interested in is in contact with a bath, along with which it makes up this larger system, okay? And so then if you know that the larger system is in the microcanonical ensemble, then there's a way in which you can derive that you can, you know, that's something which you've all, I'm sure, been exposed to. You can show that the subsystem which you're interested in will have the canonical distribution. But what is absolutely crucial for that is that the larger system was itself not in just one single microstate. Okay? If the larger system is in one single microstate, there is no way in which your subsystem can be in an ensemble. Your subsystem also has to be in one single microstate. So that is where you can see that these two things differ. Okay? This interpretation of statistical mechanics, where you're always saying that your larger system is in one single microstate, can never give you an ensemble for a subsystem. Whereas this one can. Okay? So it turns out that there are actually, you know, it seems obvious, you know, people of course have known this for a long time, but this concept has been revived very vigorously recently because of quantum statistical mechanics. So there are two kinds of thermalization. So let me just introduce these two and end. So the type of thermalization where there is no disagreement between these two approaches, right? Where you're looking at functions like this, which in some sense are defined over the whole system, and looking at their expectation values. So that way of looking at statistical mechanics is such that there's no difference between these two. And that is something that has now come to be called macroscopic thermal equilibrium. Macroscopic thermal equilibrium. Or MATE for short. Okay. The other kind of thermal equilibrium, which has to do with subsystems being canonical when embedded inside this larger isolated system, is something that has come to be called macroscopic thermal equilibrium is basically that you know, your limit. Going to infinity, f of x, for sufficiently macroscopic F, okay? And I'll, again, in the next lecture, we'll look at what sufficiently macroscopic means. So that's macroscopic thermal equilibrium, or as it's called, mate. Microscopic thermal equilibrium. Or mite has to do with subsystems being canonical, or getting the canonical ensemble for subsystems starting with the larger isolated system. And this point of view will not give you mite, but will only give you mate, whereas that point of view gives you both mate and mite. And it can be shown, and we'll look at that in maybe the third or the fourth lecture, in the context of quantum systems primarily, that mite implies mate. So this is a much stronger form of thermalization. Subsystems of an isolated system thermalizing, becoming canonical, than this one. If this happens, that happens. But if that happens, this doesn't have to happen, as you can see from this example. Okay? So here's now the main sort of, one of the main takeaway messages from this lecture series, which is that for quantum systems, the thing which really distinguishes quantum systems from classical systems is, in a way that we'll see over the course of the next few lectures, is that even if you take the individualist point of view, if you take a quantum system which is always in a single microstate, microstate suitably defined, and we'll see what that means in the next lecture, then even when a quantum system is in a single microstate, it can thermalize microscopically. So the individualist point of view, single microstate giving you a thermalization of subsystems, is something which can happen in a quantum system, but can't happen in a classical system. And the reason that it happens in a quantum system and not in a classical system is because of this quantum phenomenon of entanglement. Okay, so some of you, I guess many of you, are familiar with entanglement, and you know that what entanglement does is the following: that you take some quantum system which is described by some wave function, a single wave function. When a quantum system is described by one single wave function, it's called a pure state. Okay, but now when you look at a subsystem of that quantum system, the subsystem is no longer described by a single wave function. The subsystem can actually be in an ensemble. Even though the whole system is described by a single wave function, the subsystem has to be described by what's called a density matrix. Okay? And that is the reason that a quantum system, which is in a single microstate, by microstate, as we'll see in the next lecture, you know, I mean something which is in a single pure quantum state, is such that its subsystems can still have a distribution, can still have a density matrix, which is not possible for a classical system. And that, in some sense, is what makes quantum systems different from classical systems. So the title of my lecture series is Thermalization in Quantum Systems. From now on, when I talk about thermalization, when I define thermalization, my definition of thermalization is going to be mite, microscopic thermalization. Thermalization of subsystems of an isolated system, because that is the stronger form of thermalization. If that happens, this will happen, but not the other way around. So I'm going to talk about, in the next four lectures, thermalization of quantum systems, with thermalization meaning this. Okay, so maybe I'll end here. Right, so the way you physically understand this is that you're starting with some density, right, which is not a single point. So you have some volume in phase space, which is making up your initial state. And then, so you're starting with an ensemble. Now, so as I said, the objection to this is, where is that ensemble coming from? Why are you saying that you, okay, so the way that question is typically answered is that when you have an isolated system, right? So one answer to that is you're considering isolated systems, but if you look at what it means for a system to be isolated in the real world, nothing is truly isolated. So even something which you think is isolated is ultimately coupled to some bath, okay? And I mean, unless you think of the whole universe as being one, you know, as being your system, everything which is you think is isolated is actually, you know, it has a coupling to some bath. The coupling could be weak, but it's there. And so the moment you have a coupling to a bath, you could then imagine that the system is now going to start out being in an ensemble as opposed to a single point, and then this follows. Okay, so that is the standard explanation that's given. Now, you can, of course, object to that at a philosophical level, saying, but, you know, as I keep going and as I keep, you know, every bath that I encounter, I make that a part of my system and I keep growing the system. Finally, at some point, I should be able to imagine that everything is isolated, and then what happens? Okay, that's one, perhaps, philosophical way of objecting to this. But a more practical thing that's come up in recent times is that in experiments on cold atom systems, you can actually achieve a fairly high degree of isolation, in the sense that over the time scale that you perform the experiment in, you can be pretty sure with a very high fidelity that the system is isolated from its environment. Okay? And then, of course, this issue becomes important. So it's really because of cold atoms experiments that many of these, many of these concepts in statistical mechanics are being re-examined and re-evaluated, because we are now in a position to do experiments which, in some sense, test the assumptions that go behind every one of these things. Oh yeah, sure. Without coarse graining. No, so the problem is that if you don't coarse grain, okay, so right. So the thing is that what we want is the, and this is where this issue of t being greater than infinity is t much being greater than, much greater than an accessible time scale, rather than something like that, okay? So what does that mean? So that simply means that this thing that you're talking about, this exponentially falling, you know, this thing which is rho microcanonical plus something which is falling off exponentially, the time scale over which it falls off exponentially should be some accessible time scale, like a time scale for a disturbance or something to diffuse across the system. And because it's accessible, you can wait for much longer than that time scale, right? And then once you're at a time scale which is much longer than that time scale, then this exponential factor is essentially gone. And then you're saying that this has become this with no correction, essentially. And then you're back to the same problem. See, if you could let this tend to this very slowly, then it wouldn't be a problem. Well, I wouldn't say coarse graining is really shortening. Okay, I don't know if that's the way I would think about it. The way I think about it is that I want this to happen over some time scale which is larger than some accessible time scale. Okay. And because it's an accessible time scale, I can then ask, well, what happens once I'm way past that accessible time scale? Okay? If it were not an accessible time scale, then the expression being way past that time scale doesn't make any sense, right? But here, if it's an accessible time scale, you know, a time scale for some disturbance to diffuse across the system, I'm not saying coarse graining makes it accessible. Coarse graining allows me to say that this is equal to this. For time scales which are much larger than the ones after which all of these things have decayed. So the important thing is there's that even though you're writing t going to infinity as a limit, you're really thinking of this being larger than some accessible time scale. Sorry? Yeah. Right. So what we'll do is we'll actually prove this in the fourth lecture for a quantum system. For a classical system, I've just mention this, and maybe in the next lecture I'll, you know, give you some arguments for why this is true. But for the quantum system, we'll actually prove this in the fourth lecture that might imply is made. No. So okay. Let me answer your question in the fourth lecture. I will give you an example of a quantum state, which is going to be in mate, meaning if you look at macroscopic operators and look at their expectation values, those would look like what you would get from the microcanonical ensemble. But you will see that in that state, a subsystem doesn't thermalize. So I'll actually give you an example of a quantum state where this holds, but this doesn't hold. But wait till the fourth lecture for that.